Hi, my name is Gyan Sahu, and today I'll be presenting our paper on accelerating lattice-based proxy re-encryption schemes on GPUs. So this work is a joint work with my advisor, Professor Kurt Roloff. And in this presentation, I'll be introducing you to the topic of proxy re-encryption. Secondly, I'll be justifying you the needs of accelerating a proxy re-encryption scheme. And lastly, we'll be discussing our implementation of VVPRE and RingGSWPRE on NVIDIA GPUs. But before we start our topic, let me take this moment to thank the Programs Committee of CANS 2020 for all their support and accepting our work. So without further ado, let's get into the topic. So what is a proxy re-encryption scheme? So in simple words, we can say a PRE scheme is a secure access delegation technique that is built on top of a public key encryption scheme. And what it does is it allows for users to exchange information or confidential information without ever sharing any secret keys. So let's start with the syntax of a PRE scheme. So apart from the regular procedures that are found in a public key encryption scheme, such as keygen, encrypt, and decrypt, we have two additional procedures, namely re-keygen and re-encrypt. So this re-keygen, it takes in the public parameters and the secret key of Alice and the public key of Bob, and it generates a re-encryption key. Next, the re-encrypt algorithm, it takes in the public parameters and the re-encryption key that was generated in the earlier step, and it takes in the ciphertext from Alice and it basically transforms it into a ciphertext that can be decrypted under Bob's private key. So the diagram on the right, it shows one round of message exchange which is powered by PRE. So here we have two users, Alice and Bob, which are interested in exchanging information, and they basically exchange this information through a proxy server, which is referred to as the Poly. The re-encryption key is stored with the brokering party or the proxy server Poly. When the message from Alice arrives at the proxy server, it transforms the ciphertext using the re-encryption key RK that can be read by the user Bob. So it is worthwhile to note that the PRE schemes that are under consideration, so they are considered to be secure under the INDCPA security notions, that is roughly similar to the security notions for public key encryption schemes. So next, coming on to this Poly, the proxy authority. So it is worthwhile to note that the proxy authority, it is not a fully trusted entity. And by that we mean that the proxy is allowed to snoop into the data, but it runs the protocols honestly. And further, the re-encryption key that we have with the Poly, it is basically a public key which doesn't reveal the identities or the secret keys of either parties. So even with the possibility of a collusion, there is no extraction of secret keys of either parties. So let's see some use cases where PRE can be deployed in real world scenario. So in the first example, we have a web service which is running some sort of data analytics engine on encrypted data. Now the service itself can be working on different databases or maybe distributed databases which have their own secret key and public keys. So in this case, the PRE server, it can aid in the conversion of messages or the secure transfer of data from the databases to the web service for consumption. In another example, PRE can be really useful in message transaction in a Kafka cluster. So Kafka has large number of producers which generate streaming data and consumers which then consume this data. So in this case, a PRE server can be deployed on the Kafka cluster itself, which brokers then these messages between the producer and the consumer. So here is another use case where PRE can be used in the context of authorization and resource sharing in the OAuth protocol. So OAuth is a fairly popular protocol these days for delegated authorization. So here is how it works out. So we have a resource owner and we have a client application that we are working with. And this client application, it can be a financial analytics application. And for that purpose, it wants to interact with our bank records. So in this case, it reaches out to the banking server, which in turn reaches out to the banking authorization server. So this banking server then asks us our login credentials. And if it is granted access, it will be sending out a web token to the client application. And with the help of this client, of this web token, the client application can then get the resources from the resource server. Now, if our data on the resource server is really important, then we can encrypt it. And in that case, we need to deploy a PRE server so that it can re-encrypt the data and hand it over to the client application. And in that case, we don't need this access token further. So now in all of these use cases that we discuss, it is of utmost importance that the PRE server works in real time and that too with the least possible latency. And for that purpose, we can use some accelerator to accelerate these computation. And most commonly, so these accelerator, they can be ASICs, FPGAs, or GPUs. So in our approach, we have taken the GPU approach to accelerate these computations for PRE algorithms. So now let's discuss some of the advantages of lattice-based PRE schemes over other traditional PRE schemes. So the PRE schemes that we are working with are unidirectional in nature, and this helps us in having a stricter access control over the proxy, as it can only re-encrypt or work in a single direction given a certain re-encryption key. Secondly, our PRE schemes are also multi-hop in nature. That is, once the receiver gets the ciphertext or the re-encrypted ciphertext, it can re-encrypt further without having the necessity to decrypt it. And further, this can go on multiple times depending upon the number of hops. And one of the major advantages of RingLWE-based PRE schemes is that we can re-encrypt multiple messages at the same time in a single ciphertext. And the highest number of messages that can be encrypted or packed in a single ciphertext is equivalent to the RingLWE dimension of the instantiated scheme. And lastly, and most important of them, is that the lattice-based encryption schemes are inherently parallel because of the RingLWE arithmetic structure. And further, unlike most other traditional encryption schemes, lattice-based encryption schemes are devoid of any modular exponentiation. And this makes them further amenable to parallelism. And we can use all of these discussed factors to our advantage to accelerate all of our PRE schemes on NVIDIA GPUs. So let's briefly go over the construction of BVPRE scheme which is constructed on top of BVFHE scheme. So here the ciphertext consists of a pair of ring LWE elements in RQ, where Q is the ciphertext modulus and N is the ring dimension. So next, the decryption, it works by computing this term C0 minus C1S and reducing it modulo P to get a ring LWE element in RP as the message. So here S is considered to be the secret key and P is the plaintext modulus. So now let's consider a PRE scheme with publisher as party A and subscriber of message as party B. To generate the re-encryption key, we first compute a number of ring LWE pairs, alpha I and gamma I's. Where these alpha I's are basically generated uniformly over RQ. And then we assign the public key of B, this set of ring LWE pairs, alpha I's and gamma I's. It can be noted here that all these ring LWE pairs, they can be considered as encryption of zero under B's public key. So next we have the rekey gen, where we use the secret key of party A to generate all the power of twos. And then we add it to the gamma I components, which form the beta I ring LWE elements. And finally, these collection of alpha I and gamma I ring LWE elements form the re-encryption key. To perform the re-encryption, first we apply base decomposition or binary decomposition of all the elements in the ciphertext. And then we recombine it with the beta I and alpha I components of the re-encryption key. And after addition of all these components, it gives us a ring LWE pair C0 dash and C1 dash, which basically forms the re-encrypted ciphertext. So to accelerate the PRE related algorithms, we have to parallelize the underlying low level computations in rekeygen and re-encryption procedure. And out of these two, we have to focus more on the re-encryption procedure, as this is the one that actually transforms the ciphertext on the fly. And if we look closer into the re-encryption procedure, the key low-level computations to parallelize are the number theoretic transform, the bit decomposition operation, and the relinearization procedure. So in our implementation, we have mapped all of these functions into GPU kernels by the tools provided by the CUDA programming language. And apart from that, we have also done a lot of memory related optimization. And specifically, we have tried to reduce the data transfer between the host and the device memory as much as possible. And secondly, all of our kernel makes use of the shared memory, which is basically a local cache memory that exists on the chip. And it happens to greatly improve the runtime of the kernel. And lastly, we have used some of the CUDA intrinsic functions to reduce the latency further. So we have used the CUDA random number library, which gave us nearly around 5 times of improvement in performance. And we have also used the stream feature of CUDA to launch all of these kernels in parallel, which basically allows them to pipeline the processes and thereby they save some of the execution time. So let's look into all of these low level computations one by one. So the first one is number theoretic transforms or NTT. So what is NTT and why are they used here? So we can say briefly, we can say that The entity operations are mainly used for multiplication of Turing LWE polynomials. So as you might know, the regular multiplication leads to convolution with quadratic time complexity. So polynomials are for that purpose evaluated with entity and always kept in evaluation representation for their efficient multiplication. So in terms of implementation, the entity algorithm, it looks very similar to n-dimensional FFT algorithm. And the only difference here is that we are using modular arithmetic instead of complex numbers. So as you might recall, n-dimensional FFT has log n stages with roughly n butterfly operations. So in our implementation, we have mapped all of these butterfly operations into CUDA kernels with appropriate synchronization barriers. So in essence, where it would take n operations of butterfly to compute each of these stages on a CPU. So in our kernel, all of these butterfly operations, they happen simultaneously. So thereby saving us a lot of time. However, so one of the difficulty we face in our implementation is the hardware limit that is set on NVIDIA GPUs. So the number of threads that can exist in a block, they cannot exceed 1024. So for that purpose, for higher ring dimensions, we used a combination of global stream synchronization and block level synchronization. And for smaller ring dimension, so we use this these block level synchronization entirely. And these block level synchronizations are very fast than stream level synchronization. So the next low level operation is the bit decomposition operation. So they are required mainly in the re-encryption procedure, as the input ciphertext now has to be broken down into low norm polynomial, which basically results in the low norm or the low noise re-encrypted ciphertext. So the bit decomposition, first of all, it appears to be an inexpensive operation, but in reality, in ring LWE cryptography, these operations are very expensive. And this is mostly because the cryptographic elements are preferred to be kept in evaluation form for faster multiplication. So now let's see how it works. So let's assume we have a polynomial in evaluation representation. To bit decompose, first we have to apply inverse number theoretic transforms on it to bring it back into coefficient representation. And now we can apply the bit decomposition on the individual indexes of the polynomial, which basically results in a number of independent low norm polynomials. So you can see like these polynomials have 0 and 1 indexes in their indexes, and that is why they are low norm polynomials. And now on each of these polynomials, we can invoke the number theoretic transforms to bring it back into evaluation representation for faster multiplication. And this is where we can take benefit of the CUDA code to parallelize them. So to parallelize these operations, we first map these individual low norm coefficient polynomials into a three-dimensional grid of three thread blocks. And thereafter, we can apply number theoretic transforms on them in parallel. And this is where we can get the maximum performance when compared with the CPU execution. So the final operation where it all comes together is the relinearization procedure. And it is mainly used to produce a low norm product of two ring LWE polynomials. So we have this general formula which says that the dot product of bit decomposition of polynomial A and power of 2 of another polynomial B, it produces the product of the two polynomials A and B. And the only reason we do not go for a direct product is to avoid the excessive growth of noise in the re-encrypted ciphertext, or here the final product A and B. And in essence, this is the entire process of relinearization. And the final dot product in our implementation is done by a logarithmic reduction algorithm, which tremendously improves the speed by parallelizing the reduction algorithm. So finally, let's take a look at some of the experimental results. So in our experiments, we use two GPU devices, GTX 1050 and the Titan RTX. So this GTX 1050 is a low-end commodity grade laptop GPU with 640 cores, whereas this Titan RTX is a powerful GPU with 4608 cores, and this is the one you'd normally find on a HPC cluster. So we instantiated our BVPRE and RingGSW PRE scheme parameters for 128 bits of security, and with ring dimensions ranging from 512 to 16384. And in our case, fortunately, we could stay within the 29 bits of modulus, which fits nicely into the 32-bit integer size of NVIDIA architecture. So in the first graph, it shows the performance metrics of the entity algorithm. So from this graph, we can see that for smaller ring dimensions of 512 and 1024, the CPU code runs slightly faster than the GPU ones. And as we increase the ring dimension, the performance improves by a large factor. So this next graph, it shows the performance of bit decomposition procedure. And in this graph, we can see that the runtimes are faster even for the smaller ring dimensions of 512 and 1024. And it significantly improves even as the ring dimension increases. And in the end, we can see that we get a high performance for our BVPRE re-encrypt runtimes, which is basically the runtimes improves by a factor of 39 times to 228 times when compared to the CPU code. Similarly, for our RingGSW PRE code, our runtimes improves by a factor of 3.5 to 11 times. So this decrease of performance is due to the fact that RingGSW ciphertexts are basically matrices of ring LWE polynomials, and to re-encrypt them one by one, it takes significant time. So thank you so much for listening so far, and if you have any questions or if you want to share anything, so you can reach me out on this email, and you can also find the code link here. You can go on to this link and check out the code for this paper. Thank you so much.